Hello there, and welcome to Women's Business.
My name is Dr. Marianne Shallcross-Smith, known to most as Dr. Daycare, and this is my co-host, Amy Vogel. We'd like to welcome you to our mentoring program designed to educate our community on issues facing working women. We will be speaking to our guests in the areas art, sciences, health, education, law, medicine, politics, community service, military, and business.
The goal of the show is to provide information that comes only from personal experience and to pass this information down to our daughters, nieces, neighbors, family, and friends. Much of the content will relate to the guest speaker's journey in their profession, what they have learned most about this process, and what they wished they had known before this journey began. Since women-owned businesses are the fastest-growing sector of our economy, my guests will close with what lesson they would like to pass on to the viewing audience. Good morning, and today's quote we'd like to begin with is, women and girls should be able to... I was doing so well.
The DVD didn't go. There's a new DVD player. It didn't go.
Okay.
Well done.
You're a good camera woman.
All right, no, I'm going to start with this.
Amy said she was doing really well. So
I know.
No, do it. This is working out well.
Okay, we like it.
Really, I do. Because we're flip-flopping the way you're doing. Thank you for taking the trek from South County. So I know it's Rhode Island.
That's okay.
I know it's an hour. It's But
the big problem is not up this way, but down by us, because there's no ramps. It's all lights until you get above a certain point, like the Home Depot. It's all lights.
Yeah, room four.
And 138 is two lanes, and people get into the university. Summer people. Yeah. There's no excuse for that. But every time they try to bring up. Yeah. A new road or a new change, new configuration, they get voted down every single time.
Yes, they do, yeah.
Swamp Yankees.
Mm-hmm. Yes, they are. Absolutely, yep.
Unbelievable.
The traffic is horrendous.
Yeah, and they don't want to do anything about it.
No.
Newport's the same
way. My sister won't even leave
a lot of
the Narrow
people
River.
Don't.
She won't even come and visit. She goes, Marianne, it's 2-hour travel sometimes.
Right. You have to leave real early or real late.
Real late, yeah.
My class at Bryant started at 6, so if I didn't get on the road by 5 o'clock,
okay,
I was late.
Ready. Okay, ready or ready?
Yeah.
5, 4.
Good morning, and I'd like to begin today's show with a quote. Women and girls should be able to determine their own future, no matter where they are born. Melinda Gates.
And thank you for joining Women's Business. We are honored today to welcome Mary T. O'Sullivan, and she is joining us from Encore Executive Professional Coaching.
Thank you.
Thank you for coming.
Great
from
to
South
be
Kingstown.
Here. Yes.
Wow, early in the morning. This is pretty cool.
I know. I didn't need a passport.
So tell us a little bit about you.
So it's sort of a long and winding road, my story.
Oh, great.
Actually, there's an article in Rhode Island News Today where I kind of wrote a little history of how I got to where I am now.
Let's hear
so
it.
So the I think it's coming out, the August 26th Rhode Island News Today.
Oh,
so
cool.
My story, many years ago, I didn't have any clue what I was doing. I was about 23 years old, and I was living at home. I felt like I didn't really have a future. I couldn't get a job. And I had trained as a school teacher. And at that time, teachers were just abundant all over in the early 70s. Mm-hmm. So I got a job up in Syracuse, New York. And I was a school teacher there for about 10 years. And schools always go through some kind of financial issue. And things were happening where things weren't getting fixed. It was a great high school. There were a lot of money in that town, but the superintendent was extremely cheap with his repair. So there was a hole in my classroom window.
Oh,
somebody had broken a window and they left it there. So long story short, I was looking for another opportunity. And because I had worked part-time at GE over a few summers, which at that time was located in Syracuse, mm-hmm. New York, I was fortunate enough to actually get a job there, a permanent job. And I had that job for about 3 or 4 years. And then I was kind of looking to advance, and I felt like I was sort of at a dead end in that particular job, and I wanted to move ahead. So I started to inquire around and used my connections, and I ended up getting a job in Nashua, New Hampshire, of all places,
oh, wow.
from Syracuse to Nashua.
Yes.
And I worked at Sanders for about 2 years. Then I moved back to Syracuse because my husband and I were planning to get married. His job was there. And okay. I came back to GE as a consultant. So I worked there for a while, on and off as a consultant, pretty good money back in those days. And then that dried up because at the time it was under Jimmy Carter and the defense budget was shrinking down.
Oh,
so
God.
I had to find something else. So I started to look. My mother actually was working in sales for Thomas Register, which is industrial sales. You sell to like welding shops and guys that do powder coating, specialized powder coating, beautiful finishes on cars. Mm-hmm. So I learned a lot about stuff that I never knew before, which was kind of interesting. And I did that for about 5 years. And then after that, I ended up going back to GE again. So I was
God
back,
bless GE.
Back at GE.
You had a good resume
thank
with
you,
them,
thank
didn't you?
Thank you. Yes, and it's a great company to
yes,
work
they
for.
Were, absolutely.
Learned so much there. It was a wonderful place. Well, we were there for quite a while, and my husband was also working there. And then his job got transferred to Australia.
Oh, wow.
So we were in Australia for a year.
So you followed the job?
His job.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm just saying, you followed
I was the woman that followed the husband, to Australia.
That's a cool place to follow.
That's
into.
A
well,
great
it's
space.
Absolutely gorgeous.
I've been there. It's
but
beautiful.
If you've ever
beautiful.
Seen Crocodile Dundee, that's what you have there.
Yes,
you do
is.
Not go to Australia for culture. It's a beautiful place.
Yeah.
Sydney's wonderful,
beautiful, yeah.
wonderful. And Melbourne, I never got to go to Melbourne, but mm-hmm. Sydney was amazing. Gorgeous place, the harbor's crystal clear. So we were there for a year, and we get back, and about 3 months later, my husband gets laid off from his job.
Oh my goodness.
Because we didn't win that particular opportunity that we had all moved to Australia for.
I'm with you.
So
it's
he was
business.
Looking,
it's
he
business.
Ended up, yes, that's the way it is
that's
in business
is.
Today.
Yeah.
And so, we were looking all over. What happened was that his old boss was in East Windsor, New Jersey, got him a job down in East Windsor in the satellite business. And I was kind of like, what do I do? You know, didn't have any connections, didn't have a job. One day I saw an ad in the paper, they were hiring, and they weren't hiring in my department, they were hiring in some other department, but they gave the fax number for the HR department. And I sent my resume in. I get a call because they called my boss in Syracuse to ask about me, and it was all because I knew somebody.
No.
And I got an interview, got the job, so I was there for about 5 years. Then he gets laid off again. We end up at Raytheon up here
oh, yes.
in Rhode Island.
Sure, absolutely.
Right, defense
Middletown,
business.
Right?
Yes, over in Middletown. And that's where I ended my career. I was there for about 14 years.
At Raytheon?
Yes.
Oh, wow.
Yep. And again, I learned so much at these companies. I learned so much at Raytheon. I got a great education and background. I got my master's degree there. I got all kinds of wonderful certifications, Six yep. Sigma, contract mm-hmm. management. It was just amazing, and I took advantage of everything. So my dad had died. It was a big, long story, and I decided, you know, I can't work like this anymore. It was too much pressure. My husband had a death in his family. So there was a lot going on, and I really had to leave. So I got lucky enough that, thank goodness, I knew the director. She allowed me to take a voluntary layoff with all those perks that come with it. And that included
wonderful.
Outplacement coaching,
oh, that's wonderful.
A tuition stipend, you know, severance package. It was great. So I advise people, don't just walk away. See
absolutely.
Whatever they're going to give you.
You know, if a woman in business, Shel, that's excellent. It's never come up in all these years. That is
right.
a very important
aspect to tell women out there, because I think they have to walk away, leave a job, and you just summed it up in a very different perspective.
Right.
And so deserved, too.
Right.
All the years
exactly.
and time you put into that company.
That's
absolutely.
The whole point.
That's the
whole
point
I try to
Thank
tell
you for sharing
people,
that.
Especially women, also men, they get very angry and they want to just walk out.
Absolutely.
And so if you can take the emotion out of it, if you can step
like
back, you know, if you can step back
logical.
From the all the things that are happening to you and don't take it personally, if you can just look at your position objectively, you know, you can actually get everything that you want from your company.
Mary, you got a lot to offer here today. Thank you.
And they're very willing to
they
help
are.
You,
they
as
are.
Long as you play your cards right. You can't be angry, you can't be nasty, you can't threaten to sue them. You just play your cards right. It doesn't matter what the reason is. It doesn't matter if they've somehow offended you or they violated the law. It doesn't matter. You're not going to win those cases anyway, which is another whole interview. But they will be nice to you if you are nice back, right? So as a result of my outplacement coaching at Right Management, which is an excellent outplacement company, the executive coach there offered me the opportunity of becoming an executive coach. So I took my tuition stipend and I applied it toward the University of Texas at Dallas, and I got my graduate certificate in executive and professional coaching.
That's amazing.
Wow, what a journey.
What a journey. And now, the rest is history.
Now, I'm going back to the very beginning. Just curious, you taught high school.
Yes.
What subject did you teach?
I was an English teacher.
An English. I kind of thought of that.
And I'll tell you the reason
you're
why
you're a very
that
good
worked,
writer. That helps too, doesn't
well,
it?
Well, it does. Yes. But the reason that helped me so much is that when I went to work at GE, I started working on their proposals, and they needed people to edit them into proper English because the engineers are not famous for their writing.
Yes, absolutely.
So I would take their work and make it into something that was palatable and marketable.
Yeah.
So that was part of my job. And I do love to write. I did actually, while I was there, I wrote speeches for some of the executives when they had to address their congressional delegation. I wrote a lot of letters.
Gosh.
So yeah, I just made the most of it, and people appreciated my talents. That's one good thing about working for a really good company like GE, is if you're good at what you do, they recognize you.
That's
and
wonderful.
And they pay attention to your talent.
That's wonderful.
You would think a business that big wouldn't do that, so you kind of just reframed it for me. They do realize the talents that they
right.
have.
Right. Well, at that
they
point,
nurture them.
Jack Welch was the CEO, and he believed strongly that people are the most important capital.
I read that in his book. Absolutely.
Without really good people, your business isn't going to go anyplace.
That's right. People are
number one.
Right.
Human capital, absolutely. Wow. So you taught a lot of information about where you're from and today. And is there anyone that you can go back in your life that was influential in your life?
A person?
Yeah, a person.
Or people.
People.
So the honest answer there is that along the way, I took advantage, not in a bad way, but I leveraged the connections that I had.
Absolutely.
So one of the girls that I taught was the daughter of the manager of that entire department under which proposals were, and he asked us English teachers at the high school, does anybody want to work for the summer? Of course, we were all starving over the summer as teachers. We weren't making a lot of money, so we had families to support. So yeah, myself and one other teacher took the job, and I took it 2 or 3 years in a row.
That was smart.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And it was a great exposure to big companies. It was a great exposure to technology at the time. I got so good at writing about these things that actually when talking to some of the engineers, I actually knew a little bit more than they did.
You become an expert in it almost.
Yes, because you see it every single day.
And you see it from
exposure.
You see it every single day. And not only that, but as part of my job, we had to match up the illustration or the photographs with the writing and then put a little caption under there that was a marketing caption that told a story so that we knew that the people who were doing the evaluations on the proposals were not reading the whole proposal. So we had to show pictures and make sure the picture told what we were trying to say in that entire page, because a lot of them, we actually got questions back from people because we knew they hadn't read the material. So we started to get better and better at providing captions and providing headings that people could read.
It's interesting that you said that. Last week I had to go in front of a board. I went back to my marketing director, my educational coordinator. We came together for a very fast meeting. As I need to be able to give this board something, a picture. Mm-hmm. Like, well, no, I'll put it in writing. No, they need a picture.
Right.
Like, well, I don't think that's going to work. I go, trust me, I was a school board member for many things. I could not read all the materials they gave me for that meeting.
Right.
The pictures said it all
exactly.
to me. And then from there, you can ask questions. So they immediately put the whole perspective together in picture, plus, of course, we put some explanations at the board.
Right.
The woman picked up the picture, and she goes, I'm going to start with this and work your way. And
exactly.
the most information can come from is people, what they depict it, and can educate a whole group
exactly.
of people.
And
I'm so glad you said that.
And
wow.
there's a lot of logic behind what
yes.
you said.
Yes.
I use graphics a lot in my coaching business.
You do today, too?
Yes,
wow.
because people don't always understand what's happening to their brain when they react. So I have graphics of the brain doing different things. So for instance, there's a great picture of the brain on empathy. It says, this is your brain on empathy. And it's all lit up on that side that has empathy, the empathetic hormones and all
it,
of that
yeah.
kind of stuff, like dopamine and oxytocin.
Yeah, totally.
And you know, it's very different from the other side of the brain. And then there's a part of the brain called the amygdala. And that is where your emotions are rooted and seated. And so what happens is that when people get really upset, it's called an amygdala hijack.
Takes over.
Yes, exactly. And that means you're sort of blind to everything else and you're just reacting. So it could be a word, it could be somebody's gesture or posture, or something you see that can hijack your brain and out come all these things that you really
didn't want to
say, or you were really sorry afterwards, or maybe you got in trouble for. Now, I know it's happened to me. It's actually happened to me with clients, so I had to apologize because my work is not about me. It's about my client.
Can you give me an example of that?
Yes. So one of my clients was a lawyer.
I got it.
And he was talking about some case where there were depositions or was something happening in court, which is what had actually happened to me when I was getting my divorce. And I was flooded with these images of what happened. And I just started talking about, you know, my experience, and I could see him going like this. And I'm thinking, oh my God, this is a hijack. You know, I need to get back on track with my client.
Yeah.
So, you know, he was very patient, but I knew I couldn't do that again. It was a good lesson. I had another client
wow.
who was very triggered by emails and text messages that he was getting overnight because his company ran 3 shifts.
Yep.
And so before he would go to work in the morning, he would read his emails and he would read these text messages and he would get so upset. By the time he walked into the office,
yes.
he was ready to yell at everybody.
Wow.
And that's what he was doing. And so we backed up into that. And I said, here's what happened to you. You had an amygdala hijacking.
Mary, that's pretty cool.
And so your brain took over
oh, wow.
all your logic. And he was an engineer. All your logic disappeared. All your rational mm-hmm. thinking went away. And your amygdala took over. Now, the amygdala is kind of a primal part of the brain. And so you don't want to be, you don't want to be sort of ruled by your lizard brain, right?
No.
You want to be able to use logic. So we worked very hard on having him learn to step back from all those triggers. Another word for amygdala hijacking is trigger.
Mm-hmm.
So how do you stay back from the triggers?
Mm-hmm.
What I suggested is that he turn off his phone at 7 o'clock at night
yeah.
and not turn it on until he got to work.
And
in between that time, maybe if he got up a little earlier, do some exercise,
mm-hmm.
do some thinking, don't use anything in your earphones, just, you know, go with the dog or, you know, just be out in nature. you know, with a flashlight if it's dark in the morning, you know, but you need to get that nature in you, and that automatically calms down. There's a lot of science behind that also. Mm-hmm. That nature does tend to relax people. That's why we like to go to the beach. That's why we like to go camping. Because that environment is very soothing to human beings. And so he did that. He went out jogging in the morning, regardless of weather. He didn't listen to anything. He actually got an accountability partner, another friend who was kind of going through the same thing with him. And he, by the time he got into work, he was calmed down. So I asked him, so how is the morning greeting going? He says, what do you mean by morning greeting? I said, when you walk in, are you saying hello people to people? Are you making eye contact? And some of the feedback I got was that he wasn't. He was just rushing past people. And I said, you know, if you want cooperation, it's all about what you give
out. Stop in and say hello, and how's your day?
Stop in and say hello. Bring them some coffee.
Yep.
Have an off-site or just a casual meeting. Yep. Take them to lunch. Those are the kinds of things now that we're looking at that are considered the hallmark of leadership.
Absolutely.
So to be a good leader, you cannot have an amygdala hijacking. You know, you have to put on the empathetic brain. You have to put on a whole new way of thinking, and those are all learned. Mm-hmm. Those are all learned things. And so if you don't learn them, you're just asking for trouble.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Now, did he own the organization or did he work for
it? No, he was a senior director.
Oh. Now, did they have an expectation that he do answer his emails right when he wakes up, or was that his own expectation of what he felt he should?
Well, he thought he was trying to get ahead of things, but in fact, he was actually making himself more behind.
Yeah, got it. Okay.
Exactly.
Because he was losing himself, and therefore he was losing the people that he wanted to direct.
Got it. He was losing his human capital.
Sorry?
He was losing his human capital.
He was definitely losing human capital, definitely.
Wow.
And that took 6 months to work out with him.
Wow.
So he was on a 6-month program with me. And the way we measured success, based on science again, is we did a leadership 360 survey prior to the coaching.
Yeah.
And then at 3 months, I said to him, do you think you're ready for your second 360? And he said, absolutely not. So we did another 3 months of coaching. And at the end of 6 months, we did the second 360. And the improvement was unbelievable. It was off the charts.
That's great.
Yeah, he did a great job.
So with all your expertise, why do you think, and it's many human beings who are pretty much in business, why do you think they feel they have to get up in the morning before their feet hit the ground and do all this?
Well, there's a lot of pressure on people.
Pressure, thank you.
You know, that kind of hustle mentality, there's a lot been written about that in Harvard Business Review and Forbes. The hustle mentality is kind of hurt people in a big way, and that's why we're all feeling so much stress.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And anxiety, and our blood pressure is going up, and we've got heart conditions. We're on all kinds of medications, especially as you get older. It gets more and more difficult to handle all the work that's put upon you.
Yeah.
And like I was talking about earlier before we went on camera, today's workplace is based upon major productivity. So they have to maximize productivity. How do they do that?
Metric.
Fewer people, more work, right? So you kind of have to navigate those waters when you're put into that situation. You have to learn to modulate and prioritize what is the most important thing. And that's what gets done. You can't be fighting fires all day long. And
exactly.
I don't think a lot of people understand that.
Mm-hmm.
Look at the firefighters that are on the front lines of any fire, you see, they can't be out there more than a couple of days. They have to get rotated out and fresh people come brought in.
Mm-hmm.
So it's the same mentality, that constant stress is what really ages people, hurts your physical health, hurts your relationships, hurts your mental health, and can really lead you down a path where you really don't want to go.
Absolutely.
I always say, as much as you can, be proactive versus reactive.
Absolutely. You have to be proactive.
Yeah.
But it takes a behavior change for that to happen, because in that hustle environment, in that high-stress environment, we want to react.
Mm-hmm.
We want to be the first ones.
Yeah.
We want to do it better. work harder, get it done more cheaply. And we end up cutting a lot of corners. Mm-hmm. And you can see that in a lot of the disasters that have happened to us. For instance, that BP oil spill, that was caused because they complained about a part that needed to be replaced, and the company never replaced it because they were trying to save money. And
it's almost like the window in your high school classroom.
Exactly.
A broken window.
If they fix the window.
What's your priority here?
And we were freezing all winter long in Syracuse with a broken window.
And how did children learn? In essence,
it was so awful. Totally. They came in with their coats on.
Get the window fixed.
Yeah, it was awful.
Fix the pot.
Right, exactly. So we see that over and over again, is that to satisfy this big push for productivity, a lot of corners are cut, and it's taking a toll on the people in those environments. And a lot of us don't want to admit that we have these weaknesses. We don't want to admit that, you know, I can't get it done. Or, oh, I need help. Goodness, don't ever admit we need help. You know, that's a weakness, and I write about
that. Say that again.
Yeah, and I write about that in my article that's out in Rhode Island News. You've got to ask for help. Mm-hmm. That's how I did everything in my entire career. Mm-hmm. I found somebody that would sponsor me or help me, lend me a helping hand, and I asked, and that person was willing to help.
Sometimes when you actually have a conversation with one of your employees or team members and say, okay, what's taking you so long? Mm-hmm. And they really feel the connection and the being understood. And it's like, sometimes it's like, to be able to type that up could take me hours, and I don't have the time to do that because I have all these other things. So now I'm going to get your help to get it typed up.
Right,
but
exactly.
But it's getting them to that point to be able to have that conversation.
Exactly.
We're not superhuman.
Exactly.
And it can move that whole project right along.
And going back to my lawyer client, he had taken on so many cases, there were more cases than he could actually physically handle himself.
Wow.
So he was working ridiculous hours, like 18 hours a day, working into the night, working weekends. I mean, his idea of a weekend away at the beach was going to a summer cottage and spreading out all his work while his girlfriend was out on the beach, and he was there going through his files. Yeah. And we talked about how to solve that, and he knew he had to bring on another lawyer. But in his particular case, he was making so much money. Well, he was only like 35 years old. He's making over $300,000 a year, and he was afraid that he would lose that. He was afraid to give that up or to bring on somebody to help, even an intern.
But you actually make more money when you bring somebody on because of synergy.
Exactly.
So I know you have a couple of minutes left, but I'm curious, do you find the generation that we have now going to the workforce compared to us, the baby boomers, do you feel like they have shifted in that direction?
Because they definitely have shifted away from that hustle mentality.
Yes, thank
and
you.
I
feel
that.
You can learn a lot from,
Right, and for instance, father-son combinations, the son at 5 o'clock closes up his laptop, walks out. The father's like, hey, there's still more work to do. And the kid says, hey, you know what? I'm done for the day.
That's right.
And that happens a lot.
Oh!
And the older generation struggles with that.
Yes,
in
we
fact,
do. We struggle.
One of the guys that I work with basically said to me once, and I was actually on vacation, I was coaching him over the phone. He said to me, I really can't stand working with millennials. I really hate them.
See, I love it.
So I said to him, okay. So what's the deal? What if we took out the word millennial and we put in the word Hispanic or we put in the word woman?
Yeah.
How would that sound?
Yeah.
I said, you can't cut out an entire generation and generalize about people that way.
Absolutely.
So he really had to learn that, and it was a struggle. It was a struggle for him.
Wow. What an exciting job you have.
It was
it's
professional.
Very exciting. Absolutely.
Yes.
And to see when you can get to the core of people and the change happens, there must be self-satisfaction there too.
When I see that aha moment, that is the biggest
satisfaction.
Is that
when your trigger goes off and you get a little emotional?
Right. Well, you see somebody transform themselves.
Exactly.
And it's not an overnight process. And that's what everybody needs to know is that when you decide to take this journey in coaching, it's not for an hour, it's not for a couple of hours. It's a journey, it's a commitment.
So we have seconds left. If someone wanted to get in touch with you, how would they do that?
So they can call me on my phone directly. I answer the phone myself. My number's 401-742-4000. 1965, and my email address is mary@encoreexecutivecoaching.com.
Great.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Wonderful. Very exciting, educational show. Thank you, Mary.
Thank you so much. I really appreciate it.